day to everybody. My name is Slobodan Edic, just to have it here for the pronunciation.
A little louder?
For the, yes, for the pronunciation reason. I come from the Serbia currently. I used to live in the USA for 12 years. Currently at the Faculty of Technical Sciences of University of Novi Sad in Serbia, working in the area of my basic expertise, which is the telecommunications, signal processing, and so on and so on, and kind of making transition for the last 10 years towards the realm of physics. Here, at the beginning, just to state my case clearly, this presentation and paper goes actually about debunking of the very first established theory of gravity and orbital motion, including all others that keep the elements and aspects categories of such of that theory. It will be done, it can be seen here by the kind of that part of conservativity here or non-conservativity, in terms of having all the theories actually relying on the, or accepting or assuming the closed loop zero work systems on one side, and on the other, conservativity and concurrent use utilization of both the total energy conservation, that also means actually more specifically time invariance, and also angular momentum conservation and time invariance. And of course, the central, the very central aspect or category that mass still has in the physics, mechanics, physics, and so on. So, if you will ask me if I may have some theory or something that may lead towards such a theory, maybe that would be wider acceptable, then I can say yes. Most of the things that I've read here and my discussions here actually come from there. A particular approach of combining gravity and thermal component as anti-gravitational one in particular configuration that might be quite appealing. So we all here kind of are interested in the truth. So during my work and readings and considerations, I came up across many of the quotations, and here I have put just the three of them. This first one definitely made should relate to many of the people, you know, maybe starting from Descartes, and then maybe Lesage, or maybe Fatio, who preceded the pushing theory of gravity, and so on and so on. The second one, I guess everybody would like it, but it may also touch the Max Planck, because the problems with this constant and the experimental support of that, and so on. I don't know if you may have been aware of that. Maybe the most interesting, maybe relevant here one, in some addition, would be exactly the guy who was a politician, who may have been aware most, more than other age, any other about the truth. So, but again, so here, if I reformulate it, not only just pretending that nothing happened, but to overcome it, to circumvent, to do anything just to get through, and not only get through, but get high, in a way. So that we kind of regarding to that basic introduction. But here, now I have a presentation over you, and the first part would be kind of motivation that includes the general kind of philosophical, historical perspective, at least partly, I mean, not maybe going to present the time. And then I will go with the indicating that those two fundamental problems of Newtonian, I would say, the theory of the gravitation or the orbital motion mechanics. That is the gravitational force definition that includes mass even in the concept of gravity. And then universality of G, you know. And then fitting the elliptic trajectory, that is first Kepler law, to just one central force proportional to 1 over r squared. And the related to that, this is Newton, and these are Newtonians. The utilization of two laws, which turn out not to be law, not to be true, to be able to come to the solution for the trajectory, that very solution actually showing that the assumptions that they used to get the solution were not holding. I mean, when we are solving difference equation, we solve it, get the solution back to the equation, and check if that solution is right. So there's something ignoring or trying to avoid. This is the part that relates to the avoidance of circumventing. If we go about reaffirmation of this large concept of limitations as being pushed, not being pulling, and then kind of some related to the first bullet regarding the truth aspects. And also, very important, reaffirmation of Leibniz's two-componental acceleration that he actually proposed 1 year before he died as a reaction to the critics of Newtonians regarding the differential calculus. And somehow it happened that in the approach that I'm here going to present, it is possible to use directly minimization of work needed for a particular body to traverse certain path. So not minimization of variations in terms of Lagrangians, Hamiltonians, and so on. That would be kind of used to show how things should be done, maybe after showing what has been wrong. And of course, everything then may implicate needs of a revision of very fundamentals of astrophysics, quantum mechanics, and electromagnetics, and maybe also other things, other areas. So, back to motivation, or at least very general motivation. Okay, he is wrong. He may at least get what I have here on these slides. I decided to put them here. Actually, 10 years ago, acquisition of certain startup company in California got me into the CERF company, which was doing the GPS receivers. And I was assigned task, pretty tough task, wrong was that, to deal with the problems of reception of signals in the urban camera environment. In particular, I was given the RF samples.
Okay, that was my fault. Go ahead, keep
going. Yeah, so I can go with talking, right?
Yeah.
So okay, my goal actually was to analyze the data and try to figure out what should be done, And then what I got, that occasionally actually the reflected components, that correlation peaks that receiver is producing, I was using the C code that they using the chipset itself, occasionally were revealing correlation peaks that were coming ahead of the line of sight component. Well, I mean, okay, until then, I was really fond of fun. I was living in Princeton, you know, what everything. And start realizing that I'm clashing against his second order, second postulate of special theory of relativity. And then, of course, because of that, I lost job, but that kept me into the realm of physics to see that hundreds of thousands of people are on the opposite sides. Half of this conference is devoted actually to that. And here, if you will be allowed to be. Okay, so this is how it will be a kind of line of sight component and the occasional excursion to the left and more of them to the right. There might be some kind of effect of accumulation, maybe also some effect of the carrier aided loop tracking, a visible loop tracking, but if one is falling, but that may not be that important. So, what I could do myself only, I thought I could do. Was just to say, okay, if something should be independent of the some perturbation, independent of the velocity of the emitter, then there should be kind of, for us engineers, kind of Dirac pulse perturbation, right? I took the Dirac pulse perturbation to dimensional, had difficulties to get the transformation, rate transformation into the measurements of that pulse, used kind of the stepwise linear vertical results that I had. And what I got? I got that the Galilean transformation preserves the velocity, which is conceptually satisfying. Something gets off very quickly, and then there is no way to from traditional velocity to a part. What special relativity theory Doppler, which is actually asymmetrical stuff, gives is that the very level of that perturbation depends on the velocity. So I thought maybe something like, you know, ad absurdum, prove that something definitely should be wrong. And when it comes to the verification, we're talking here about different possibilities. The laboratory with different elements, there was a presentation with some like cliff and everything. We could do it really in engineering terms. I mean, we have here, this analysis reveals that there is Doppler shift imparted shift in the group. It can be interpreted as delay, but actually, essentially, it should be kind of dilation and contraction of the pulses. So maybe this first pulse that should be narrower than this one. But it's very just 2 kilometers sounded that Ilman University has that can resolve 1 picosecond, and some mechanism that have a rotational movement, one transmitter fixed and 2 on the rims, signaling a particular instant, and then comparing what we get. Einstein would say just 1 sample, and the emission theory would say 3 samples. That one would be narrower, that one be as would be expected in such a situation, and that one would be right. So that part of our, I mean, regarding just these aspects of the my involvement in the area in general, and then relating to the special relativity aspects. So here, in general, the further motivation. So as I said, it goes here about direct critique of methodology employed up to date traditionally. And based on what I was able, had got the chance to do by kind of extending the concept of Professor Gordic back in Serbia, who some 30 years ago came with the concept of orbital motion as combination of attraction, as a gravitational attraction, and thermal counter gravity. He got into that really kind of experimenting with the wave bearing of the metal cutting tools, materials, and kind of got to that, and of course could not write thesis in that domain, and so by chance, a friend of mine is here, actually he had gotten me to be in contact with the guy. So I wanted to help him to articulate that. I saw a quantization of the trajectories of the orbital paths in the solar system, you know, I was really glad to help. And with the time, actually, it developed in the other direction, how say, somehow, because of my ability to look into internet and re-examine the Newton formula for 9 times, never being able to accept how come at one side the force depends, is proportional to mass, on the other, next sentence in textbooks, without but, however, said, bodies with different weights are accelerated same way. No, kind of, so here's the historical, it's very interesting here. So, Aristotle's that kind of had that doctrine, having a body falls faster. It lasted for 1800s, and 18th centuries. But with the central role of mass is still unrefuted. On the other hand, he had the concept of unmoved mover, that might be kind of the ether as a potential structuring substrate. And then he had also kind of really concepts of force. It has been mentioned, but like contact force and maybe at least conditionally non-contact force. In terms of applying F equals E A, M times A, or maybe third law, action-reaction, and so on. So, as I said before, the Leibniz two-component acceleration came up during that course, and I came across Engels' The Elective Nature, where he was deliberating if there is gravity, there might be anti-gravity. He said, there might be having some form of heat. It was kind of interesting for me to have. So, Lesage being pushed, not be pulling, if it could be briefly formulated, and it would be important to the extent that Aristotle's doctrine was kind of progress hampering hypothesis. That happens also maybe with the general Newtonian theories. So, we go now to the maybe part that goes about just gravity, force, and orbital motion. I borrowed this from the book of a friend of mine now from Serbia, who came up with again some combination of solar, of thermal and gravitational component, and developed the theory of sun functioning as a gaseous substrate and so on, and was thinking of mass as that context, and the gravitational as negative mass. He was actually a student, I mean, physicist by training. So the idea here is what Newton would have thought if that apple had been caught, kind of. So maybe we would be having some different theory, maybe not really having many troubles and problems. Refutation lasted really long, all the way until the 15th century when people started dropping stuff in Italy, those priests and so on. And we got to the Galileo, and then he did it scientifically on the skewer, and got this wall. And but look at this, when it comes to the just common sense. Back in first century before BC, there was a guy, Lucretius, who was stating this. Therefore, all things carry on through the calm void, moving at equal rate with equal weights. And he just was thinking this way. You have two bodies, okay. Heavier is falling faster. We attach to it the lighter bodies. The lighter body would be pulling it up. But both of them are heavier than that one. Should go there. So there should be nothing. We will just go. Okay, I thank to the professor who had presentation last year in Belgrade. So when it comes to the there's the criticism of Newtonian dynamics, there's the proportionality of the mass, and this stuff, independence of acceleration, and the general kind of satisfying oneself or themselves with the need of for using initial conditions and even incorporating, allowing for initial conditions to be incorporated as part of the natural laws. There was one Nobel laureate actually who has something like that in his speech that should be really kind of maybe not that acceptable. So when it comes to getting to the, it was mentioning how Newton got the formula by looking at the apple, looking at the moon, and so on and so on. So, I was looking at the moon, maybe not the apple, at least not this, to say maybe not his law, second law is the plan. So, he had this, what is A? And he said, okay, this is going around, should be falling, why doesn't pull? Okay, there's the initial conditions. So, he took the three laws of Kepler, Huygens' law. You may have known that Archie Cook had suggested to him that the force that creates ellipse should be 1 over r squared, but this is a big kind of quarrel about that. But he apparently wanted to get that. So he took the velocity on the circle, this is period of orbital, and this is kind of semi-major axis. Semi-axis, right? I put it here as an average to stress that it's constant. And this is for circle. And then combined the third Kepler law with this velocity, got the force as constant times mass divided by d squared already, goes to the goal. This is actually the Kepler constant. The constant is really constant on solar system, but not on galactic systems. So, I mean, that would be, if one would have known how he developed this, then the problem of galactic anomaly would be maybe tackled a different way. So, at the last step, what he did, he took actually the same formula and just multiplied and divided by m. And then kept the 1m in the numerator, And yuan that comes in the denominator, he proclaimed as a constant. Maybe he did not, but maybe his followers did definitely. So this comes like universal constant. This comes like inverse dependence of the time varying. But time varying R squared, and all the time he we were dealing with the constant value, with the as a constant. So really big question marks and big problem here. When it comes to rationalization, explanation of that fact that different bodies of different weight accelerate the same way, and one says, okay, larger body needs larger force to have certain A, and lighter, smaller. Okay, guys, okay, we get this, oh, wow, empirically and formally, we get it. But, as may have been suggested regarding the relative movement, so, the same way, then, the Earth attracts these two bodies, one by one, etc. We don't have to look at them as like just really independently. And the same acceleration happens for Earth with respect to those bodies. Now the formula doesn't hold, because now we cannot have this acceleration same, because the masses are same. Because now masses are getting into the numerator, not in the denominator, you know, to get it into some constant or things like that. Okay, that will be for that part. Next one. The first, this was just preparation for the main task, maybe, to show or to find force. But it turned out apparently to show that 1 over R squared is causing the electric path. So what he did it geometrically. And Feynman had noticed that problem. And there is a book recently published, maybe not recently, but maybe not something that Feynman had wanted to be published. Name is The Lost Lecture of Gravity. He noticed the problem at a particular step when Newton refers to the conical sections and tried to solve himself by constant phase increments. So did not make one presentation. There is an audio record and some papers that people luckily had found. Did not do anything, get into the quantum gravitation and some. The first one really great chance we missed. And when we go now to the contemporary derivations, what is going on? For example, to show that the force here is 1 over R squared, general, let's say, vector analysis is used. Velocity is decomposed into the radial and lateral, also acceleration, and we get two components. This is the expression for radial acceleration, and this one is for lateral. So still not tangential, but maybe they, of course, they are related. And look at this. This part is tangential acceleration. That should be something that makes difference between the elliptic trajectory and the circular trajectory, right? But they did everything to eliminate it. So they say, okay, this expression can be transformed to this form, R squared times first derivative phase. This is then Keplerian surfaces, second law. Okay, for circles will be fine, but I will be thinking a lot to stay there for this situation. And then said, okay, this is constant, this is zero. Then lateral acceleration is zero. The solution itself provides a radial acceleration not zero, tangential acceleration not zero, non-zero law and so on, but nobody cares. Proceed with the datum level and everything. So this is how the product of R squared times first derivative phase looks like. Maybe a little bit exaggerated because of eccentricity factor 0.85 e equals y, but put it Earth's eccentric eccentric factor or whatever in MATLAB, you get here difference. You never would get to constant here, as would be, for example, this average value. So this is how one proceeds just with the radial component of acceleration, and then putting the
parametric equation for ellipse, one ellipse, one gets this what Newton had gotten and what everything wanted after Newton to get. And they got it. On the other hand, this component can be resolved into this. Nowadays, it is being doing like that, the two components. So, if one does this presentation again, one can get resolve the inverse problem. To get the trajectory that is caused by one or a square, but this is not done properly. So here, I will just ask for your attention here. Dynamically, this equation is nonlinear equation and so on, and mass comes on all sides, on both sides, you know. At this point, we could have just removed those masses, right? And would see at this stage that mass, the same way as it irrelevant for gravitation in terrestrial sense, is irrelevant at all. Well, as the professor said, bodies moving through calm, void, things like that. You know, this is something really that he had that feeling about free fall and things like that. But, of course, because they don't set it properly, the mass reemerges in the situation where the so-called law of energy conservation is deployed together with the conservation of angular momentum. So this is the connection between then the T and R. This is something that can circumvent some problems that Kepler had traditionally and so on, but maybe not be important to go at this stage. So now it comes to the modern situation, actually. Okay, this is the problem with the conversion. But it doesn't matter. This is just close the bracket and so on. So what I say, this is the kinetic energy. This is potential energy, this is total energy. These two parts are interpreted as maybe, okay, this should be a third degree here. So they proclaim it as effective potential. Look at it here. This actually should be kind of acting, maybe, I don't know if I got the proper science. Against the attraction, they proclaim it to potential. So everything is depleted and analyzed as potential fields in which closed loop work is zero and so on and so on. Although the fact of getting non-zero works. So the solution here for, look at this, not R as function of T, but T as function of R. Anyway, but the mass is here, getting back in the game. Not only to the constant of gravity, but to mass of the body. And there was some discussion mentioning of mass of body, and you were talking about maybe you're looking just mass of body. You know, I don't know to what extent is maybe supporting this or vice versa. And on the other hand, okay, here is that mass gets in again. And here is the so-called law of the conservation of angular momentum. Since this is not constant, what they're using as a second branch of proof of derivation actually is nothing else but second derivation of phi is second derivation of phi. I mean, many people are really interested and eager to criticize Einstein and his derivation of relativity theory, you know, finding absurdities there and so on and so on. At least the modern interpretation, Newtonian interpretation, maybe general relativistic as well. I don't know how they're doing the solutions. The dynamical problems, they are doing the same, they're having the same here. So here is how, I have shown before how energy is constant. It was not constant, right? For varying the time. This is the product of R squared and first relative phase. Is it constant? It is not constant. This is the variation of energy on the radius vector, indirectly on time. Affects the potential, you know. All the physics, everything, biology, everyone is satisfied with negative energy. And then some solutions, some problems, those mass defect, right?
can be sometimes resolved, okay, this is energy there, and that energy is negative, and these are all positive, so we got negative. I'm just totally kind of bordering on the absurdity, really. So, negative potential energy, okay. In combination with kinetic, can be positive, and it can be something like in traditional terms of dynamics, mechanics and dynamics. But on the other hand, we could get back maybe directly to the Leibniz criticism, you know? The guy apparently had better knowledge, at least of the little bit advanced calculus than Newton had. This is evident by this formula that he proposed. The same formula is visible in the conventional derivation. He did not, of course, support Lesage because of the problems. And somehow, historically, when comes up with something, like for example, here we had presentation about Earth growing, other people say, okay, it's not possible because this. Everything should be re-examined, get back, all the time cycling. There was a presentation about organization of the group discussions and so on and so on. That's really something that was advocated there, as far as I remember. So now we come to what Professor Gozic did. She set it differentially. He said, differential energy or work needed for the segment of trajectory R is inverse proportional to R squared. This gamma, not necessarily Newtonian gravitational constant. On the other hand, the component, now I have said, Engel's component, or his thermal, or maybe dark energy now, component, work is proportional to mass, still have mass, right? This is body mass, just looking at it in traditional terms. Thermal capacity, look at this, thermal capacity, and change differential temperature. Now, what is dependence of temperature on distance? In the first paper that's going to be published next year in the Galerian Dynamics, I was trying different things. I said, okay, if we know this, what is ellipse, we can infer what is the dependency. I never got to it, but got across the work of Milutin Milankovic, who has been famous for the climate change theory that he generated maybe 19 years ago, became famous of that. In there, he was mentioning that the planets are warped, being warped, but said by the same very precise law as is Newton's law of gravity. Of course, that law is okay. So he said 1 over r squared. We have here differential of t. If f of r is 1 over r squared, the proportional to it, the first derivative is what? Minus 1 over r to the third. We have this. Okay, sine plus minus here depends how you orient your directions. So we got this. We got Leibniz, back to Leibniz. Leibniz derivation, this should not be constant because we have the C that people are looking as a constant. But anyway, so this is constant, R squared, R term. Yes.
I have a copy of a translation of Newton's booklet. It's a booklet called Motions of the Moon. David Gregory translated, put it in English. He didn't give figures, I didn't see the figures. And Newton had trouble describing motion of the moon. So I read this trying to see if he actually used his equation one over r squared. I never found 1/r² in that book. I did find him saying 1/r³ in that book. But not 1/r²
here. Yes, thank you. In the email discussion before this meeting, there was mentioning some of that. The people coming with some information like this. Yeah. So old Newton seems to be much, much. We can say, a good guy then as young, because as a young, he was reading before he did everything. Was reading Descartes. Descartes, Principles of Philosophy. There has been a book recently published. I read it in German, from Latin translation. The book is On Gravity. That was book, actually notes, that Newton didn't want to be published. How German managed that to get from the English, I don't know. Here, first is criticized, wondering, getting frustrated, frustrated and so on, and by the end of those notes, he's setting his laws and his principles that later that leading to this. But later we see that many things, even in Hitler, so what Lesage and his pupil, Patio, Patio proposed actually first the pushing effect. Lesage kind of continued this on. So anyway, thank you. Now I get here to one part that also kind of stepping up and discussing, and it's relevant to many presentations, including yours, and the just recent one. Since all this got me into the realm of ether, you know, I had gotten to the magnetics, was looking, seeing how people are extending, not only that Max, that Hertz had reformulated that with the full derivatives of time instead of partial derivatives, so that Lorentz force naturally emerges and so on, but of late, particularly in the context of aerodynamics. So it turns out that those basic stable structures as toroidal vortexes, which are depicted here, the vortex is like this, and then this is kind of cross section, and this is also cross section in this plane. So we have movements actually. The ether particles, those compressible viscosos and so, are moving in this way, from inside out, and also from out of the of plane of the slide in the kind of circle. So if you have two particles, gas dynamically, Russians strictly distinguish between fluid dynamics and gas dynamics. That's from that field, but the gas dynamics has those features of so-called creation of those kind of layers or layering effects or something like that. But anyway, what happens actually just through pressure, within pressure, within the velocity. So the velocity, the attraction between these movements, circular, go with 1/r². Those one that correspond to the toroidal movements, to 1/r³, to the third. And then, with the interpretation of this movement as electric field, and of this movement as generating magnetic field, you know, those movements actually, the field is moving, and we're describing actually that movement as magnetic, very consistent electromagnetics emerges, extremely extending the Maxwell equations, and also evolving the not only longitudinal waves, but also scalar magnetic field as divergence of A, of vector magnetic potential. So anyway, because earlier I was in touch, I was following what Ron Hutch was doing, and the first thing that impressed me was not the GPS domain, because I was just entering that area, but was an article that I saw that he kind of proposed alternative formula for gravity with respect to the Einstein's one. Instead of the Lorentz factor, he used the exponential factors. But in first approximation, he had the same thing. What is interesting, and striking me a lot, is actually that he had the same formula. The only reason, the only difference would be conceptual, gnosiological, epistemological, and things like that. That because beside of this one stays something like which is really maybe, you know, ether and being pushed and not being allowed to be attracted and so on and so. But I wanted to have it here. So we have kind of here kind of discriminator characteristics. Now I go to the, okay, this is how it would be looking in the maybe different situation, coaxial, coplanar and so general case.
Are those toroids?
Toroids, yes.
Okay.
Like smoke rings.
Yeah.
So now, just kind of, again, quasi-static or quasi-dynamic situation, just to illustrate, to bring this closer to you, the concept of gravity as being pushed and anti-gravity heat as not allowing for that. Phenomenologically, not allowing for that would be, okay, heat is extending the body, so those particles that are hitting and pushing, they're hitting less. Oh, maybe going to the lower level. Heat emitting that means emitting part of the structures. So then part of the structures of those vortexes getting out, those getting in their place. So they're more not pushing. So kind of, but okay, this is just some indication. So anyway, this is kind of situation. If we would be wanting to get back, get Earth back to the closer to the sun, we should be cooling it. And when it's going to come away from us, it will be heating it. Yesterday, I kind of really apologize for losing temper, you know, just stepping up in the situation when the pretty obvious facts and pretty convincing facts that the Earth is increasing and even energy is kind of right, increasing and so on and so on, was kind of being suppressed by violating the traditional, classical, and general gravitation, a bit of motion theory, I really couldn't stand. So now it's just kind of, okay, these guys are very close to each other, okay? Who cares? I mean, the mass is increasing, mass is pretty kind of suspicious category, right? Heat, yeah, heat is increasing, okay? Heat may be more relevant. Okay, so now, what? If they're increasing and heat be heated, so, you know, they'll be allowed to move from each other. And now, related to this, you may all also be familiar with the Pioneer 10-11 number. I'm using this just to get to that part to suggest what the true solution would be. The current accepted solution was that the generator is situated close to the ignition chamber. And after some additional modeling of thermal drift diffusion on bodies that some Portuguese guys did, in the sense that this heat is directly hitting the dish and everything goes to the, what? This is a relation of the linear momentum law. So the sail of cities, it's a sail blowing in the sails and everything moves, right? But with this approach, as I say, very important, informal is just formally 1 over square times 1 minus 1 over r, or it's something that has something hypothesis. Right? This may be biggest error of you, not wanting to set hypothesis. So what's going on actually here? Could be going on. To the extent this is hotter than the other side, all those particles that are hitting here and providing gravity 1 over r squared, now that force is reduced. So the force that comes outside, that we had also in the presentation, is prevailing. That's why anomalous so-called acceleration towards the Earth of this very tiny amount, but it had a lot of trouble to people, both in JPL and the Aerospace Corporation. And so now, they must have different vehicles over there, right? Those vehicles might have been generators on the other side. I asked them to check if they had the anomaly, but this anomaly now is on the other side. That anomaly on the other side, they would be kind of, more eager to explain, because they would say, okay, solar pressure, things like that. Actually, all the time, they were fitting the measurements with the modeling until up to 20 astronomical units. At that point, they had to give up. At that point, that anomalous acceleration could make the trigger. I've been communicated at that time when I thought that I could resolve that problem based on the problem with the second postulate. You know? Later, I saw the error of 10 to the minus 6, but the same shape of those curves. So here is how it could be done.
You're fine. You have 20 minutes.
Oh, great. So here's how maybe the orbital motion in general should be set up. So we have some situation, some center, we have some body, that can be even some center that was a presentation, wondering how come those stars are going around, what is inside that what is that spot? Lucas.
No, it was Ed Dowdy.
Oh, yeah, okay. So, you know, if we have this maybe as kind of reasonable approach, it's kind of really that everything is happening by two counteractive processes. You know, the libels, besides the form of acceleration, he was attacking the third into the law, equaling action and reaction. He said, okay, action and reaction, I will say it a bit now, the blind to the contact. By pushing this, that push is pushing me. But he said, on one body, one should not consider and just accept that both action and reaction could act on the same body. That means centripetal and centrifugal. Okay, maybe on the third one. Huygens did great work there. But people just were blindly following it. So Leibniz was strongly critical. And then Leibniz, I just spot some passages from this biography. The last years, I cannot believe how he could have lived that 1 year or a couple of years. What were things that he was doing? What problems he had politically and other things? So, we take these two components, being attracted and not allowed to be attracted, and in terms of gravitational and gravitational, Esagian and thermal. And then take the walk over the path. And take this absolute value of the work. I consulted some physicists there. Okay, say, if I'm accelerating somebody, I'm engaging force energy. If I'm deaccelerating, I suppose I was still investing somewhere. Yeah, so you can do it freely. So I took this. And then projected this central force on tangential. So tangent of the curve, I don't know, one should know what the form of the curve is, but if one takes this projection and this expression here and this angle, I found some derivation, some place in the reference in the paper in the internet, and calculates that work and minimizes the orbitals will emerge naturally depending on these parameters. Gravitational, it generally should depend on the configuration. Of course, there's kind of mass, the density, but also shape. Tesla was always talking that gravitational constant should be dependent on the situation, should be dependent on the body. Most important, not more important, but maybe equally important, thermal coefficient. Well, we are talking about heating, I mean, accelerating universe, dark energy, and so should be relevant. So, based on this, one can really kind of get into the more accurate, maybe, predictions and evaluations than on the basis of the Newtonian work and JR theory. Because, in particular, that we always do everything like that. We have defined mass of the sun based on the theory. We have defining mass of galaxies. We defined missing matter because of this. So, that might be really, there's a big whole part in all theories. So what I did, one could do it, as I said before, one can take just R of T, R depends on T, and phi depends on T, can have these parameters, whatever, for galactic, whatever, can involve third body, whatever, and then find the dependence of R and phi on T that minimizes this expression. I tried it, you know, but somehow I had some problems that it was pretty much present in the Latin stuff here to provide paper itself. But what I did, I took this very same nominal Keplerian ellipse, and I did vary this form along the vertical axis. So I would kind of be distorting this nominal Keplerian elliptic path to some other paths that are not Keplerian, expecting that work evaluated on that one that corresponds to the Keplerian ellipse will provide a minimal work. What? Guess what happened? Oh. So this is the situation. See, this is the nominal ellipse. This is how those phases or radius changing in the time. No, of course, we don't have the best time. I mean, I will have a presentation to Tesla Tech regarding this, the situation in general, and kind of some other things could be really clearly indicated, but okay, sorry, I don't have that much time. So this is that angle that actually gets involved in the decalculation of projection of the force or acceleration of the tangent. And this is the first result. This should be one here, right? And that one comes here. Comes here. Sorry, but it comes here. Exactly the one. So, all the other shapes, this time deformed ellipses, need larger log to be invested. The minimal log, positive log. Corresponds to that nominal. First law, Kepler first law, ellipse. This is the situation, zoom in, and that those are problems. Who is dealing with mechanics knows that kind of probably the Cartesian and polar coordinates and so on. This is something that is induced by those very kind of inaccuracies and so on. Look at it. Lagrange, Hamiltonian, formalism, they go with the energy, but then kinetic minus potential. I mean, potential is negative, but just, well, I don't know how Lagrange came to taking kinetic minus potential to get something positive, I guess, to be able to somehow vary the equation and so on. If one takes, look at this, that goes back, that leads us back again to Leibniz. Time integral of time of time variation of kinetic energy. That's same as log over the path. So this is how it looks like. Because of different coordinates, maybe this is not falling directly to one, maybe there is something kind of distant. This is now how it would look like with Lagrangians, you know, integral of line, t minus u. This is the variations that actually people are using to get solution based on the Lagrangians and maybe later Hamiltonians. There is some indication that that minimum is also here, right? But when I look at the variance, that variance gets a little bit away. But when one takes this Lagrangian, that means that we have here just v squared, and it gets back to the Leibniz so-called vis viva as alternative concept of momentum of mv. This kind of indication, but it's got pretty like a natural, like satisfactory that you think of, that you really have to some kind of change the kinetic energy when it comes to the energy and work. So that's all regarding the results. Just maybe some two slides with firstly implications on general revision of astrophysics, quantum mechanics, and electromagnetics, and maybe other fields, so at least revisiting some parts. So this concept, I contributed to turning it to thermogravitational oscillator because Professor Gorin had it TDO in the domain that he did up to the level of the differential equations, those are statements, and all the time sticking to the Newtonian, like constancy of angular momentum, but having very interesting insights and kind of visions that he actually had acquired and implemented one mechanism, so-called Serbian energizer, that actually was based on such principles. So here, it turns out that we really don't have to look into the dark energy in the dark matter. So, one thing, matter is mass, and difference between inertial and what was the gravitational mass, that actually should tell us that there is no way, that it is just the wrong postulation. I mean, postulation based on wrong theory. On the other hand, dark energy, no. I mean, yes or no, yes. Energy is actually anti-gravity. So putting it in the right context, totally different picture, with a very, very kind of very modified would be emerging. Quantum mechanics. Those guys started from Newton law of gravity and could not zero work, could not explain why atom is radiating and electron doesn't fall into the nucleus. Yeah. So, I mean, based on this stuff, and Dr. Cynthia Whitney, he has a book, Algebraic Chemistry. He has that result that on atom level, we have come electron clouds and protons and so on, and she was considering two components. If it were not for those components that he came up to, I don't think that she would have accepted the paper to be published, being, I guess, as many pretty kind of fan of Newton and the dynamics. And, you know, the zoological derivation actually transferred to the electrostatic, magnetostatic, and then Maxwell converted it to kinematic. And now Professor Lucas may be having a session to somehow, yeah, make that resistor smooth, and maybe get something that you have that divergence in the ether of both B and V, I guess. I will look maybe later into. So it seems that this attraction and repulsion be the universal mechanism I was discussing along those lines. So the only difference would be the set of constants. And they should provide those quantization. I mean, quantization in terms of the quantum ratio, generally nonlinear dynamics. And then one result that Professor Lucas came up with here, and he said, is actually you have to go only with nonlinear dynamics. But do it properly. The basic formula for gravitational plate motion is nonlinear, but it's not done properly, as I think I have shown here. So, no need for turning a lot of physics, right? No mass, maybe I did something, said something ahead of that. Either substrat might be really kind of substrate from where everything emerges and into which everything gets back in terms of kind of really kind of recycling, again, as I had the opportunity to comment. I mean, this zero-point energy should be given soul, kind of, right? Zero-point energy is something like annoyance in physics, right? Some fluctuation, some randomness. It's totally different from looking at something like energy or that structure as something as Aristotle's unmoved mood. Again, and then, because of that, all this, and what I just hinted and could discuss about the ether, really it would be good to get back to the Cartesian, but maybe Descartes physics, vortex physics, and all the people who, maybe even not even knowing for him, did a lot of work and really came up with good results. I listed here Bauer from Germany, that had some religious results, attacked by other people, always attacking on the ground of something which is untenable. Okay, see, I mean, regarding the rotor, if there is a rotor of the field that depends on time or not, that guy came up with indication, and maybe very similar to what I came here with the work aspect. He got the potential, body potential, but somehow positive constant that actually is related to the structure of the very basic vortex. He was looking into the work done over all those trajectory of that fluid. Was criticized. I got that book from just recently. I just heard about Radu. I got the book now.
You have 5 minutes.
Achukovsky. Really, I mean, if there was some way to organize and find somebody to translate and invest on our side, it would be really good investment. Evert in Germany, of course. Yeah, in general, electrodynamics. Thank you very much for your attention.
We only have 5 minutes for discussion, so go ahead, you can call on them.
Yes, please. Excuse me. We're very happy to have you come from your part of the world, Slovakia, and
Serbia.
Yeah. And the believe Boscovich came from there and Tesla came from there.
Boscovich, yeah, his father was Serbian. But no, to the extent he contributed something. Regarding
the, to the extent, okay, his father was Serbian, right? Mother was Italian. They live in Dubrovnik. Nowadays, it was the Serbia and later, just one period of time, but that doesn't matter. For one thing, it was Newtonian, kind of. But he evolved kind of the concept of attraction and repulsion. Without going into it, what could be the mechanism, cause for that? That could be going as a fault of him. And some people actually are blaming him some kind of being pretty much as having retarded developed the physics, of course. Maybe true physics. We have contributed to the atom physics, you know? Because, again, in quantum mechanics, nobody knows where those forces come from, attraction, just guessing and so on and so on. So, you know, can be looked at as this way or that way.
But he gave the logical, he's the first person to give the logical argument that continuity requires that there be a universal force and not separate electromagnetic forces, gravitational forces, strong interaction, weak interaction, etc. So I cite him in my book because he had a great insight.
Microphone.
In half of his drawing, you will see the ellipse. Then everybody here, he was looking at into this. Look, this is kind of central force from the okay, central body. But he was looking about on this component here.
Because he was evolving another component.
Right now, I wanted to comment to you. I worked with NASA with satellite orbits and planetary orbits, and I developed the first software for a computer called quasi-linearization that enabled the solving of the orbital equation because NASA was losing track of the satellites that had put in space and couldn't find them. And they knew where they were at a certain point in time, but they didn't look at them regularly, and then when they went back to find them, they didn't know where they were. And so anyway, what I was going to say is the orbits are not ellipses, neither of planets nor of satellites. They are, according to the laws of Newton and that sort of thing, they should lie, like the planets should lie in the equatorial plane of the sun, but they're all tilted. They should not be quantized, but they are. And they're not true ellipses because they're actually a toroidal plane. And it has a cross-sectional area of the actual secondary motion in the orbit. And we just averaged that out in astronomy because we didn't know what to do with it.
Okay, maybe after this presentation you may ask those guys there, Dr. Lichten and others, to get me to the JPL to give presentation. Otherwise, I had proposed to them on several occasions. At that time, with the special theory of relativity and multi-path modeling, and just this last year, when I was presenting a Tesla Tech paper on this background, this TGO theory as an indication that we have free energy, that we have kind of perpetuum mobile. Yeah? So if you compare the work done by mass and acceleration, tangential, and the other hand, what is the amount of heat that Earth had been receiving during that time? Compare joules and see, the fish is bigger, it's the same. Right? So, I mean, really, kind of, you know, we are talking about this at SPI and Renamon 10 to minus 10, so. But you know, some situation may arise where the big threat for Earth and humanity can become. Unless we are knowing a little better the basic principles, we don't believe. So somebody maybe putting bombs, atomic bomb to the asteroid. But if you induce heat on the other side of the disaster, that guy would.
Okay, we'll have to stop there, okay? Thank you very much.